If you have a smart speaker, you have access to the entire world of NPR and St. Louis Public Radio. All the latest news and all the captivating stories. Activate our voices with yours by telling your smart speaker to play St. Louis Public Radio.
Missouri lawmakers are headed back to the Capitol this week, and State Senator Jake Hummel says Democrats in the Senate will have a lot to combat during the second half of the legislative session. The St. Louis Democrat joins us on another edition of Politically Speaking, so let's hit the music.
This is the Politically Speaking podcast, a candid conversation with the Show Me State's biggest political newsmakers.
I'm Jason Rosenbaum.
And I'm Joe Mannis.
That's Eric Greitens, Navy SEALs running for governor, and I'm really, really glad to be on with you, Jason and Joe.
I'm going to push back on these regulators.
I'm doing this for the people.
I was encouraged along the way, not just by my family, but by a lot of teachers and professors, and knew when I was in college that I would run for office someday.
We're very excited about the prospect of having some more free market solutions.
Even though after the conversation, I still might not agree.
We want our listeners to get a real sense of what drives these people.
They're actually people with a story to tell.
And welcome to the Politically Speaking podcast. I'm your host, Jason Rosenbaum, a reporter with St. Louis Public Radio. Joining me in studio today is
Joe Mannis.
And joining us for the first time as a state senator,
Jake Hummel.
I was going to say something more
profound.
More profound and flowery before that, but the senator short-circuited me. This is your fourth time on the show.
It is.
Do you know about the curse of the fourth?
I thought it was the curse of the third you told me last time, which is why I was really looking forward to the,
now
the fourth
it's the
meeting.
Fourth now, because it hasn't hurt Schmidt at all.
Schmidt, and it did not hurt Scott Sifton. The curse is that people who have been on this show four times have suddenly had to resign, either in disgrace or for good reason. But those two aforementioned people have broken that curse, so you are safe. So,
yeah, I was going to suggest we meet next week and have another one then.
Oh, my gosh.
So then after that, actually the number of people who it's meant nothing now outnumber the people.
Yes.
That's a good thing.
It's no longer a curse.
One of the interesting facts about you becoming a senator during an unexpired term is because of when you were sworn in, you could actually serve for the next 10 years.
Is that correct? It is.
And that hasn't happened very often. I think Victor Callahan may be the only person where that fell into, but
I think Senator Curls gets at least 9 years.
Yes.
If I'm not mistaken, but I believe I'll be the first senator since term limits to get 10 years.
Yes, it's kind of part of a change in the term limit laws that which I think was passed in 2002 because there were some instances where somebody would be elected to the Senate in an unexpired term. Mm-hmm. And they could only serve 5 or 6 years.
I think it was the Jefferson County rule because of what happened to Brainlock, but the father of the recent last Democrat state senator.
Bill McKenna?
Yes.
And also Maida Coleman fell into that
role but Bill McKenna, it affected him.
Yeah. So I believe it's if you serve one day less than half a term, it does not count. One day over does count.
Now, right. just remind our listeners, what does the 4th District encompass? I mean, I know it because I live there, but not everybody does.
So it runs from basically the farthest southernmost point of South St. Louis all the way to the farthest north point of the St. Louis City, all the way up to the Chain of Rocks Bridge. It goes out into St. Louis County, picks up Richmond Heights, Shrewsbury, parts of Maplewood, goes out Highway 40 to McKnight, picks up Brentwood, just on the edge of Ladue.
And wasn't this at one time, maybe the boundaries were slightly different, occupied by the infamous Jeff Smith?
It is. Actually, I just recently got a piece of mail addressed to Senator Smith in my office, and I sent it to Senator Kevney and told him that clearly there was an oversight that they had missed him as well.
Is he still an administrative law judge?
Yes, he is.
I didn't know whether that was a fixed term or whether he got swept out of office after Greitens won.
No, those are actually those judges are retained by a board made up of legislators that I believe happens every couple of years.
Right. And I think he recently resigned as 28th Ward committeeman, which
he held
for a long time.
He actually did that right after the selection process.
So I Lyda Crewson's Twitter account actually pointed that out. But enough jibber jabber. We're here to talk about kind of what to expect in the second half of the legislative session.
Sure.
As I'm sure many of our listeners know, the Democrats are outnumbered, but in the Senate, they could potentially put up a fight.
Yeah, and you have kind of a unique perspective because A, you used to be in the House,
right.
And B, you're a statewide labor official.
That's correct.
So, I mean, you have kind of different perspective than maybe some legislators who didn't have that experience.
Sure. I'm trying to find a job I'm good at, Joe.
But it hasn't been a good couple months for labor.
Yes.
And we all knew that this was coming. I think that it was pretty much a foregone conclusion once Eric Greitens won that quote-unquote right to work, which is shorthand that proponents use to describe a bill that would bar unions and employers from requiring workers to pay dues as a condition of employment, was going to become law. And right now it hasn't become effective, but it was passed.
That's right.
So as somebody who has given a lot of blood, sweat, and tears to the labor union movement, had to be disappointing when that occurred, but not unexpected.
Sure. I mean, we knew it was coming if Eric Greitens was sworn in as the next governor. And, you know, it's something that we've worked hard to present or to stop. But, you know, that's the reality that we are in. And as you were probably well aware, we have ballot initiatives that we're going to do. We're going to do a citizens referendum and hopefully take that to the voters, which would, if we collect enough signatures, that's going to freeze the law from going into effect until the voters have a say in November of 2018.
So how's the signature gathering going?
Well, we haven't started yet. There was a lawsuit that was filed, we've resolved those issues, and we're probably only a week or so away from hopefully having that ballot language approved. You know, it was ridiculous. It went so far as to say, well, we need to know exactly where you're going to put the staple on the page before we approve this. And so it was very clearly a delaying tactic.
By Ashcroft's office?
Yes, to slow down that signature collection process. But in a very short time, we think that that's going to be approved, and we'll start collecting signatures.
Well, the big question I've been asking is, because the amount of Missourians in labor unions has dwindled over the years, they've become kind of compacted in the urban areas, and you have to get signatures in a certain amount of congressional districts.
Six of eight.
Yes.
And many of which may not have a lot of labor union members there now.
They have retired.
There may be retirees. Is that going to be a problem to get signatures?
No, I don't believe so. Actually, in fact, in six of the eight congressional districts, we already have the density if we just had our members sign on.
Really?
Really?
Yes.
So if it ends up being put up to a citizens referendum, based on the results of the last election where somebody ran for governor, mm-hmm. said, I'm going to sign right to work, and the people elected him. How do you think that reality would make a ballot measure fair, essentially?
Well, let me give you a very, hopefully, a brief story. A friend of mine who's an electrician, as I am, his wife is a public school teacher in St. Mm-hmm. Louis County. And after the election, you know, she went to school, and some of her teachers noticed that she was upset. She was nervous. You know, she was worried about her husband's occupation and their well-being as a family. And you know, some of the teachers had asked her. They said, "What's the matter?" And she said, "Well, you know, I'm really nervous about my husband's job right now. I'm nervous for the future." And she said, "Why?" And she said, "Well, I'm sure that now Greitens is going to sign right to work." And they said, "Well, what do you mean he's going to sign right to work? He never said anything about that." Well, you know, you and I,
we
read the paper. Of course he did.
In fairness,
it was all over public. It was all over social media. It was in all the newspapers.
I wrote about it several
Absolutely.
Times.
Absolutely. But I think that what we found is that even among our educators, we have a lot of people that do not follow the news on a daily basis. I would bet that, you know, the readership of the Post-Dispatch is down. You know, I know that when I started as an electrician in 1997, when I went on a job site, every single person at my table at lunch had a newspaper. And if you didn't have one, you could borrow someone else's, but everyone said, you better get a newspaper and become informed. And when I stopped working in the field, I can tell you that I was the only one that had a newspaper and that everybody got one or two things from social media, and that was it.
Well,
so we have an electorate that is increasingly uninformed, I think, and I think that's a shame, but they didn't realize what they had done.
Well, I was just going to say, I've heard anecdotes from both union leaders and lay members that a lot of their colleagues voted for Greitens and Trump, even though they knew potentially what the stakes were. But that signals to me two things. One, it could be that they weren't educated, but two, the Democratic candidates didn't do a very good job of pointing out that if they voted for Greitens, right to work, or any of these other labor stuff we're going to talk about was going to happen.
I agree.
Yeah, I don't think Koster underscored it enough.
Right.
Now, but to be fair, when Trump carries a state by almost 19 points, and I've told Koster this, so I'm not saying anything, is that chances are it probably wouldn't have affected him. He lost by five. Maybe he would have lost by two or three.
I agree with you. I could. It's hard to overcome a 20-point deficit for anybody. And you look at how well Trump carried the state. I don't think there's anything that Chris Koster could have done differently that would have carried him over a 20-point margin. I mean, it's just almost impossible to make up.
So I want to talk about what's coming next, because right to work, it wasn't the only thing that Republicans were thinking of doing. I'm going to play a clip now from Holly Rader, who's a Republican from Sykeston, who talked about what could be down the pike when it comes to bills that may curb the influence of labor unions.
You know, right now there is Representative Steve Helms has a bill that is, you know, one of the arguments that we've heard from the union side is the free rider concern. Right. And so federally, the Supreme Court has ruled that all the unions have to do is not put that in their contract initially. So say their contract with Boeing, they just don't put in there, that they're going to represent everyone. But the bill that Representative Helms is carrying makes that much more clear and says that the unions don't have to represent someone who's not a paying member.
Well, does that mean if that person doesn't get the same pay that the union members could pay?
That person would have to negotiate their pay with the company on their own.
So in addition to that, there's also going to be efforts to curtail the prevailing wage. There's going to be roadblocks to take automatic deduction of dues. And there has been the argument that even if right to work is repealed, if the legislature passes all these other things, labor unions' power and influence and ability to function are going to be denigrated so badly that right to work is almost the least of their problems. What's kind of your outlook for the rest of the session?
Well, first of all, that is obviously the point of passing all this legislation. There's no one beating down their door in their districts to pass this. And first, let me counter what Representative Rader said. Mm-hmm. That is absolutely not true. There is federal case law that unions still have to represent those employees whether they pay dues or not. So that is absolutely not true. You don't have to – currently right now, you don't have to be a member of a labor union.
Correct.
As a condition of employment.
You just have to pay
– You have to pay that fair share fee, which is directly related to the cost of representation for you and in your collective bargaining. So you absolutely do still get the same pay as all the union members. You just have to pay that fair share fee. So to suggest that you have to be a union member as a condition of employment is simply just not true. Mm-hmm. But going back to your point of what's going forward in this session, I think that you're absolutely right that we've seen two separate lines of attacks. We have one on reform in the court system, on tort reform, and one on an attack on working families in the state. And you're right. If we continue to go down this path, you know, we've already seen the paycheck bill up on the House, and not just. I want to touch on that for a second. Not just a normal paycheck bill where it simply says you can no longer deduct dues off your check. There was no bill to say you can no longer deduct United Way contributions on there. This is simply an attack on organized labor. But this says you have to have a new election for every public sector bargaining unit every 2 years. I mean, that's just ridiculous. We don't do that for Missouri senators. We still are elected every 4 years, and we spend $27 billion of the taxpayers' money. Those things don't hold up. There's no one beating down their doors to say we need this other than some business interests.
Well, as the number two guy statewide for the state AFL-CIO, I mean, kind of how do you counter some of this, assuming that it becomes law anyway? In other words, there are some who point to Nevada as a case of where it's a right-to-work state, but labor has arguably become more powerful because of how they've tried to make themselves indispensable to the workers and also to the employers, at least in Las Vegas. I'm just interested in your thoughts about how labor may have to retool in Missouri, or maybe not.
Well, I think that, first of all, if this passes, Of course, there's always change in any organization, but if you look at what happened in Michigan, for example, the change in membership was less than 1%, or right at 1% difference. The United Auto Workers did an amazing job in that state of going out and educating their members on why it's important to pay dues. And so certainly multiple states have done different things, but it isn't always the death blow that people take it for. I mean, people still want to belong to their union. They realize that they're not going to get these wages and benefits that everyone else has. And whether people know it or not, you know, I've talked to a lot of people that say, well, I'm not in a union, you know, why does this affect me? Well, I can tell you firsthand, because I've worked in the industry, that non-union wages are as high as they are in this state because the union wage and benefit level package is where it is. If it wasn't somewhere close to there, they would have mass defection into the roles of organized labor. And so those non-union workers are paid at a level not quite there, but a lot of them are paid at a decent level because the union wage and benefit package is what it is.
I don't want to get too granular here, but from doing some reporting, my understanding is if you're in a trade union and you depend on your trade union to get you work, the chances of you deciding not to pay dues to that union are pretty low because you see the benefit of that union because they are responsible for your living. Where it might be more consequential is if you're in a factory and you have to join in a union for whatever reason, or you don't have to join a union, but you pay a representation fee. And that's where there may be a greater effort among management to try to get people not to pay dues. That's my understanding. I'm not sure if that's what you've heard or whether people are going to pay dues regardless, but that's kind of my understanding.
I think it would affect the trades less than it does some of the other public sector and other private sector manufacturing unions. I think that's correct.
So I want to kind of shift gears to some of the other things I think are going to be impactful, especially in the Senate. The House, for example, just passed a pretty substantial changes to how charter schools are available. I know that the House Democrats were almost universally opposed to this bill, which I think basically sets the framework for charter schools to open in certain rural counties. I'm being a little overgeneral here. But one of the interesting things that I found with this issue is a lot of St. Louis and maybe even some Kansas City representatives represent areas with lots of charter schools, and a lot of their constituents like charter schools.
Right.
And it kind of clashes with this messaging that I've heard from Democrats, kind of saying charter schools are parasitic or they fail often. As someone who represents the city of St. Louis, how are you going to kind of come at this bill, and how do you kind of see the issue of charter schools, knowing that a lot of your constituents like them, even if a lot of education groups don't?
Sure. Well, it's a really complicated issue, especially in St. Louis City and maybe in parts of St. Louis County, right, where I can tell you that one of the charter schools that's in my ward but not necessarily in my Senate district is the Carondelet Leadership Academy, and people like going there. They have some of the worst test scores amongst all the charter schools in the state. What was the charter school recently that was in the paper that the sponsor kept renewing them, and they were not, their charter was, they wasn't pulled from becoming a charter school, and their test scores are amongst the lowest in the state. Charter schools came about when the St. Louis public school system began to fail, and parents felt trapped with that public school system. And so now you have these charter schools that some of them have done extraordinarily well. And some of them have not. And I would say it's probably a mixed bag, somewhere around 50-50 that are performing at or above what the public school system is performing, and 50% of them that are either below or well below. And that mechanism is currently not in place to the right degree to get rid of the underperforming charter schools. And I think that's a problem. And so now we're in a situation that is new to us, right? The St. Louis public schools have come back in a big way, and I give a lot of credit to the superintendent, Calvin Adams, the teachers union for AFT 420 under Mary Armstrong. They've partnered together to, in some ways, get rid of underperforming teachers and exchange, you know, raises for those teachers. Trying to retain teachers in an urban setting is extraordinarily difficult, especially at the salaries that they're making. And they've created a partnership, and now here we are where they're back to having full accreditation in St. Louis public schools. And so where do we go from here? I don't think that we're in a position to get rid of those charter schools that are performing, where people are sending their children. But certainly we have to recognize the fact that the St. Louis public school system has come back in a big way and has done some amazing things with what they have to work with. So it's a balance, right? I don't think that expanding charter schools across the state of Missouri is the right thing to do. Certainly understand what happened in St. Louis City, where parents needed that other option. But I don't believe the mechanism is there, even in the current bill, to weed out the bad charter schools. And that's a point of contention for me.
Now, one of the things that I've always assumed, based on when I've been in Jeff City, is that outstate legislators, and we're talking Republicans mm-hmm. here, have never been fans of charter schools.
That's right.
Because the public school system in their area often is one of the biggest employers.
That's right.
And
at the highest wages.
Yes. And all the kids go there.
Mm-hmm.
And they already are trying to make sure they get enough money for transportation, some other stuff. They're already battling the governor
right.
of their own party over some of this. So my question is this bill, does it have the Republican support it's going to need in outstate?
And I think the answer is no. And in fact, if you saw what happened with the initial vote, what was it, 83? You know, there was a significant amount of arm twisting to get that done. And you know, I'm friends with a lot of the Republican legislators outstate on different social media platforms, and I will tell you that the comments that I have seen on some of the ones that voted for this proposal were pretty brutal. And I think that you're going to find that a lot of these people have made a terrible mistake in their own districts, and it's going to come back to haunt them.
Is some of this being pressed by some of the major Republican donors, such as Rex Singfeld, who has been keenly interested in education and expanding charter schools and vouchers and that sort of thing?
Absolutely.
Well, I want to play a clip now from the soon-to-be mayor, Lyda Crewson, because I think that she's favored to be a Republican
opponent.
Yeah,
but I don't think we should say soon-to-be yet. We could say...
Presumptuous?
No, we could say that she's the favored candidate, but there are six candidates on the ballot.
So I asked her through Don Marsh yesterday mm-hmm. whether her position on charter schools, which is a lot more favorable, it's very similar to how Mayor Slay saw charter mm-hmm. schools as being kind of an instrument to keep people in the city, was kind of crosswire with many legislative Democrats. And I think it matters because a lot of times Democrats play a bigger role in charter school bills because they're in their districts. Here's right. what she had to say.
I don't know about crosswire messaging. I can only speak for myself, and that is that, you know, there are 10 or 11,000 kids in the city of St. Louis being educated in charter schools. Mm. Charter schools are like any other group of schools. Some of them are better than others. And just like St. Louis Public Schools has some of the best schools in our state, Metro High School, I think, was voted number one. You know, a year or so ago. There are also some not-so-good schools. So there is room in our educational system, I think, for both St. Louis Public Schools and for charter schools and, frankly, for parochial schools, which have done a great job of educating a lot of kids over, you know, the decades in the city of St. Louis. So, yeah, I continue to support charter schools as a choice. And I think, if I'm not mistaken, the state just this week or last week approved a charter school for all districts in the state. I think the House approved that.
Yeah.
I don't know that if that's made it through the Senate yet.
I don't think it has.
It's being talked about.
So, you know, obviously like Mayor Slay before potential Mayor Crewson, she's going to probably come to the legislature and advocate for a whole host of issues, including mm-hmm. possibly
sure.
charter schools. I'm interested how she's going to be received by your caucus in the Senate and House Democrats if she makes those types of arguments that charter schools are a good thing when a lot of your colleagues see them as a bad thing.
Sure. Well, let me start by saying this. If you would ask the mayor, the current mayor, what one of the number one issues facing him was in trying to keep families in St. Louis City, and it would be the school system.
Well, it's been that way for 40 years.
Yes, it has. And some of that is real, and I think some of it is imagined. I think that, to be perfectly honest, I think there's a stigma out there that a lot of people in South St. Louis don't want to send their kids to a school that they perceive as an African-American school. And I think it would be dishonest to say that that is not out there, because it absolutely is. And so I think that we have to start being honest with ourselves and say that it's not just a matter of the public school system failing. It's a matter of white flight, where white parents don't want to send their kids to those public schools. And whether that's real or imagined, I think that's certainly out there. And so we have to figure out a way to move past that. Our public school system is increasingly getting stronger. We've had the city voters just approved a property tax increase for the first time in, I believe, 20 years to support the public school system. And I think it's important to move in that direction.
Now, to be fair, I mean, because I've been covering this off and on for 40 years, part of the problem is also it's not just white flight, it's middle class black flight. I mean, a huge percentage of the middle class African Americans have moved out of the city into the county the last 30 years.
But to the senator's point, I made it a point to ask all the mayoral candidates what they were going to do to get upper middle class and middle class white families in St. Louis to get more invested in the St. Louis public school system. Because I tend to agree with you that if we just have a school system that is primarily full of impoverished African Americans, even if it was just impoverished white people, it's not a recipe for success.
That's right.
Because those students who deal with the problems of poverty and socioeconomic problems have less of a chance to succeed. And so the school scores are, as a whole, are going to be lower by just those types of factors. And I'm not sure what Mayor Crewson can do to reverse that. Even if she was saying we need to do this, everybody should send their kids to public schools, I'm not sure people would listen. But I think it's part of the role as a bully pulpit of the mayor's office to send that message that this needs to happen, essentially.
And let me say this. I don't believe for a second that the incoming mayor is going to be an advocate for only charter schools. I think she's going to be an advocate for St. Louis education.
Mm-hmm.
And I certainly – listen, I don't – I'll be the first person to say that if that bill comes to this floor of the Senate, that I'm not going to vote for it.
Yeah.
I'm not going to vote to expand charter schools in the rest of the state when clearly half of them have failed in St. Louis City. I don't believe that I don't believe that when you can cherry pick who your students are, that's saying that you have success in your school. Mm-hmm. Having said that, how many kids in St. Louis go to a charter school? Said it's 11,000. I certainly am not going to take that option away from them.
Right.
So we've got to strike a balance. And I keep going back to it, but the strides that the public school system has made in St. Louis City, I don't think are being talked about enough. Mm-hmm. And I think we should all, as elected officials in St. Louis, be a better advocate for what they have done and how far they have come in a relatively short amount of time.
And just to be clear, because I think it was evident in that clip, I think Crewson has done that. And I think that she has emphasized that she's going to be speaking up for all the different options. Whether that is successful, since a lot of these options compete with each other, mm-hmm. that's a whole nother issue altogether.
Now, some of the other issues that may be coming up in the second half of the session, I mean, abortion or reproductive rights, it always comes up. In some way, there's some other, I mean, I've noticed that there isn't a huge gun bill this time, but then there's the main challenge is the budget. I mean, you guys have what, maybe 5 weeks,
mm-hmm.
To get a budget passed into the governor's desk, maybe six. And I know there's lots of challenges because of the lower budget revenue than what had been expected. So I'm just interested in your thoughts about what may or may not happen, or at least how the Democrats are going to approach it.
Well, you know, if we talk about the budget for a minute, the budget that the House is crafting right now, my understanding, doesn't look a whole lot like the governor's proposed budget that has come out there. You know, one of the proposals coming from Representative Fitzpatrick is fully funding the foundation formula. And while I think that's a good thing, you know, I think that's a bit of smoke and mirrors since we've twice voted to lower the amount of the foundation formula. So just last year we lowered that amount, and you know, it wasn't a priority before, and now all of a sudden it's a priority to get to that artificial number that we just lowered, to say, look, here we are, we've fully funded the foundation formula, while at the same time the governor said, I'm not going to take any money out of K-12 classrooms, but we've cut how many million dollars out of transportation, and said, well, I didn't touch a single classroom. Well, that's just being dishonest. You can't take $50 million out of public transportation, out of school transportation, and pretend like it's not going to come out of the classrooms. Those kids still have to get to school, and that money's going to come out of the school's budget.
Well, and that particularly hits rural Missouri.
Absolutely.
Where the school districts have very high transportation things. And I know some of the other programs, like parents as teachers and other education-related things, are taking hits.
And to your point, these are his constituents that he's alienating. These charter school expansions, I can tell you that those rural superintendents carry a pretty big stick out there in Missouri. And to your point, they were they're the a group of probably the best paid people in the county. They have a lot of influence in the public arena, whether they try to be or not. And when you start taking away from those school districts, especially on transportation, I think you're looking for a recipe for disaster.
Are there any particular things that you're going to be pushing for as far as either getting in the budget or blocking from the budget when it gets over to the Senate?
Well, you know, again, not particularly as far as the budget goes. Look, I'm not on budget. I'm not on any of the appropriations. I used to be over in the House, but I can tell you that the work that the Budget Committee does, regardless of party, they work extraordinarily hard trying to craft that, especially in times of slim revenue, is extraordinarily hard, and I'm going to trust them to do the best job they can. But the governor has in the House have zeroed out the inspectors and Department of Labor.
Yes.
These are the inspectors that go out there not only on and look for prevailing wage violations, but look at child labor. And minimum wage enforcement. And I'm going to fight to get those inspectors back in the budget.
Is there any chance that higher education won't take a hit? Because I actually wrote about this for National NPR. Because so much general revenue money goes to fund higher education, it almost always gets hit when budget problems happen. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't really seem like there's really any way to balance a budget with less revenue without hitting higher education.
We could get rid of the corporate tax cuts that we did, or the 0.5% interest or income tax cut that we did. That's going to cost us $800 million.
Can you do that without triggering the Hancock Amendment, though?
Probably not.
Yeah. One of the things I was wondering about, that playing devil's advocate on some of this. Now, on the corporate taxes, you probably do run into a problem because they've been. The loss of revenue has been hugely more, mm-hmm. to quote Trump here, than what had been predicted, like 10 times more.
Yeah, I think it was $12 million it was estimated by the budget office.
So I guess,
and now
I guess
it's
this times
over $100 million.
But on the other tax cuts that are slated to go on down the road, I'm mm-hmm. talking about the individual ones, I'm just playing devil's advocate. Couldn't the legislature do something about those and not trigger Hancock if they haven't gone into effect
already?
Yet?
Well, that would take some political courage that we're just not going to see.
Yeah. On that other bill that you mentioned, it was basically a way of changing corporate accounting, which caused a lot more money to come out of the budget than expected. It's been written about several times.
Right.
One of the things I noticed is only 6 people voted against that, including a lot of Democrats voted for it.
That's
I'm pretty
right.
sure you voted for
I
it,
did.
Too. I'm just wondering, like, did you not get good information
That's
about
correct.
That bill, essentially? Like, what? Obviously, Republicans control everything, so I don't want to let them off the hook. But the governor also signed this, and that was Jay
That's
Nixon,
correct.
Too.
Well, because he was believing it, too. Now, it does mean that somebody didn't do their homework.
So what happened there?
Well, you know, look, we have fiscal oversight. We have a budget review process. You know, when we look at these fiscal notes, both sides of the aisle, when they see a fiscal note come out attached to a bill, we look at the dollar figure associated. And if I recall, and I could be incorrect, I believe that was about $12 million we thought was going to come out.
Yes, because I wrote a big story about this actually last fall when it first started showing up. And before the change in governors.
Right.
But since then, it's been more difficult to get the some state officials to talk about it.
Sure.
But, yeah, I mean, that's when it first started being noticed.
We have to trust those numbers because, quite frankly, we're not accountants. We're not number crunchers. And both sides have the ability to challenge those fiscal notes. But I think, you know, we took it at its word that it was only going to cost that $12 million. And that there was a real need to do this, that we were losing some of these businesses to some surrounding states, and we were putting our corporate tax rate more in line with some of the surrounding states. So we all went down that road, including Governor Nixon, and here we are in a situation where it's cost us an additional $90 million, and in a budget deficit year of $500+ million, that would go a long way to restoring some cuts that are going to have to be made.
Yeah, and to be fair to Governor Nixon, when only six people vote against it, even if he had vetoed it, it probably would have been overturned, most likely. Though,
but
we don't know.
We don't know.
Yeah, but everybody was, I mean, I was around when that was passed. That's how it was sold on both sides.
That's right.
So everyone thought it was like in line with the franchise tax, which basically costs about $16 million a year.
Yeah. So I do want to put that out there. I want to just ask more generally, as a legislator, what is kind of your impression of Governor Greitens, how he's dealing with the legislature? I know he's dealing probably more with the Republicans more than the Democrats, but on a charter school bill like this, where a lot of Republicans are going to defect, his relationships with the other party could matter. What are kind of your impressions of him so far?
Well, I don't know. I know that he's been invited to come and speak to our caucus, and has never come. So I've never had a meeting with him, and he's never tried to reach out to me. And to be fair, neither have I. That's nothing against the governor, but I can only imagine that having never been in office before and going to be the leader of the state, as you will, is probably fairly taxing. And I have not met with him one-on-one nor asked him to do so. If he needs to talk to me, he's perfectly willing to do with it whenever he likes.
Do you know if you're his state senator, or is Senator Nasheed his state senator?
I believe that Senator Nasheed told me that she was.
I don't know.
Are the lines down King's Highway
now, this
go back
is for
and
the
forth
place
in the central west
living
end
right now? But because they're in the governor's mansion.
Because as I've noted before, he's actually the first St. Louis City resident. He's not a St. Louis City native. He's a St. Louis County native, but he lived in St. Louis City before he got elected. He's the first St. Louis Cityan to become governor in a long time.
That's right.
And I don't know if that's going to affect how he effectuates policy in St. Louis. We're only like 2 months or 3 months into his term. I think we're going to have to have a longer time.
Sure.
But it does, from talking with him, I do get a sense he understands the issues and the problems here because he sees it on an everyday basis. Now, whether that brings about policy that Democrats that represent St. Louis City like, or whether St. Louis citizens like, remains to be seen. I don't know if you have any observations on that.
No, I hope that's the case. And, I think that the impression out there is that the legislature is run by outstate rural Republicans. And I think that's true. But now you have a governor that has at least been living in St. Louis City and hopefully understands the problems that are unique to St. Louis, to living in an urban environment.
Now, what are the other issues that either you expect to come up or that you expect to play a role in this final couple months of the session?
Well, the calendar is getting very deep over in the Senate right now, and I think that for a while there we were only passing one bill a week out of the Senate, and I think that what, at least from some of the Republican standpoint, what I've seen is that they're starting to realize that their bills are dying, that their priorities are probably not going to get over the finish line because we've been working on some of these, let's call them donor issues, for the whole first half of the session. And so I think that when we get back, what we're going to see is some of these smaller issues that...
Such as?
I think individual individual priorities of each senator, I think, are going to get a lot of floor time. Nothing very specific. I think we're going to continue to see the tort reform efforts. We're going to continue to see the attack on working families. But I think that, you know, some of the individual smaller legislative priorities of individual senators are going to start to take precedent.
Now, are there any things that, I mean, aside from the ones that we've talked about, that you plan to either block or try to block or that try to push? I mean, granted, you're in the minority.
Sure.
But in the Senate, the minority still has some muscle. Mm-hmm.
Well, sure. I mean, I have my own priorities that I'm working on.
Okay.
One bill in particular is the Anderson Electric Shock Drowning Prevention Act. We have a problem specifically down at the Lake of the Ozarks where children and adults are being electrocuted by faulty wiring on their docks. And Ameren, Missouri, the surrounding municipalities have done nothing to address the issues that are down there. And so I've been working on legislation for the last couple of years to try to address that. And so that's, you know, that's something that's very important to me. I am an electrician. I know the dangers. And it's something that no one seems to have an interest in.
Really? And now, you also have somewhat of a unique perspective because your wife just recently got elected to the...
She did. She's the Democratic nominee for the 11th Ward.
Correct.
At the Board of Aldermen.
And correct. Sarah Wood Martin, who I've known for a long time. I think I first met her in 2008 when she was managing Mary Still's successful state representative campaign.
Will that help you from the standpoint of, I mean, your wife at least giving you a sense of what's going on at City Hall? Will that, since you will be, you represent a sizable chunk of the city.
I do.
Will that help? As far as
of course, absolutely. I think it's a good thing. You know, I try to stay up with what happens at the Board of Aldermen. My next door neighbor is the current alderman, and he's going to let me know what's going on, whether I'd ask him to.
I was going
to
say Tom Villa does live next door, so I think he was going to be well informed.
I was pretty informed as anyway, one way or another.
Because I think this is an unusual situation. Although we've had another number of aldermen who have been, a number of, let's say, legislators who were committeemen, and so they're, they knew the
aldermen. I'm also the committeeman in the
Well, in fact, that's what I was just working there.
What I was just going to say, like, Rochelle Walton Gray is a county councilwoman, and her husband, Alan Gray, is a state representative.
Right.
So this is not a completely unusual situation.
No,
that's
but in
right.
the state senate it is. I can't recall
right?
the last time that a state senator had a spouse on the Board of Aldermen.
Oh, all right.
In the St. Louis.
Well, I'm happy to be hopefully the first then.
Yeah, well, does she know what she's getting into?
You know, I hope she does. Let me just say this for all of the aldermen.
Yes.
You know, when I was in the Missouri House, I had 37,000 constituents roughly in each district, and now I have upwards of 170,000 in the state Senate. For every phone call that I get. In either of those offices for a constituent issue, the aldermen each get 10 or 11.
That's
and they
true.
Have only 11,000 constituents. And so it's a different type of government. It's a closer relationship with your constituents. My trash didn't get picked up. The curb is broken. My sidewalk's cracked. The tree limb fell. The street light's out. They get all of these issues, and they struggle with funding in St. Louis City. To take care of all those services. And so the aldermen do an amazing job with the limited resources that they have, every one of them. It's a taxing job, and I appreciate all of their service.
Well, we're going to have some of the new aldermen on over the next few months. John Collins Muhammad will be on the show in April, and Sarah Wood Martin will also be invited on. I know she's really excited to especially talk about whether she's going to carry on Tom Villa's tradition of wearing very flashy sport coats.
Absolutely. You know, I have some colorful things that I would be happy to loan her, but I think we've talked to Alderman Villa, and I don't know that he's willing to part with any of his attire. We'd have to significantly alter it, but perhaps that he can show us some of those clothing locations that he shops at.
And I will just emphasize, too, that I know that future Alderwoman Martin cares more about issues than just what she's going to be wearing. I want to make that very, very clear. For all of our stories, stlpublicradio.org. Follow me on Twitter at Jay Rosenbaum. Follow Joe on Twitter at
Jay Mannies. That's J-M-A-N-N-I-E-S.
And how can we follow you on Twitter?
At Jacob Hummel.
We'll be back next time. Until then, so long.
The Gateway brings you the day's news from the St. Louis region and across Missouri. It also includes stories from the Illinois side of the river and our Metro East reporter, Will Bauer.
In Alton, in Belleville, in East St. Louis, in Edwardsville, in Cahokia Heights, at Scott Air Force Base, I'm Will Bauer, St. Louis Public Radio.
Listen to reports from Will and all of our journalists weekdays on the Gateway, on the STLPR app, and wherever you get podcasts.